This program was produced by Now You Know Media. Lectures are about 25 minutes in length and are designed to fit conveniently into your daily routine while commuting, exercising, or at home. We search the world for trusted expert presenters, record them in our studios, and deliver their knowledge to you whenever and wherever you desire. We invite you to visit our website, nowyouknowmedia.com, to explore our newest programs. This program is entitled Spirituality, Psychology, and Virtue, A Catholic's Guide to a Flourishing Life. Your presenter is Father John Cecero, a Jesuit priest and clinical psychologist, an associate professor in the Department of Psychology at Fordham University. He is also rector of the Jesuit community and director of the Center for Spirituality and Mental Health at Fordham. Father Cecero maintains a research interest in personality assessment and the role of spirituality in mental health. He published Praying Through Life Traps, A Psycho-Spiritual Approach to Freedom by Resurrection Press in 2002. Father Cecero maintains a part-time clinical practice in which he sees individuals and couples for outpatient psychotherapy.
Topic 1, From Healing to Wholeness, Practicing a Spirituality of Flourishing. This is an exciting time in the field of psychology, and especially in its approach to spirituality, because a paradigm shift has been happening with respect to an understanding of disease and health, and especially the role of spirituality in fostering wholeness. Historically, psychology has followed a medical model with respect to illness, seeing disease as the absence of disability, so that the goal of psychological intervention was to restore the individual as much as possible to what has been called a premorbid state of functioning, with as few symptoms as possible. Meanwhile, other psychological approaches, more in the humanistic or existential tradition, have focused on what has been called a salutogenic approach, emphasizing that health is the presence of positive states of human capacities and functioning in thinking, feeling, and behavior, even in the midst of anxiety and suffering. This salutogenic approach will be elaborated upon in this talk in the context of the new movement of positive psychology. Corey Keyes, a psychologist at Emory University, has elaborated upon a complete model of mental health that is a combination of the pathogenic and salutogenic. He notes that in the United States, as well as in other industrialized nations, we have undergone an epidemiological transition in the 20th century, where we have experienced an increased life expectancy by some 30 years. But at the same time, there has been a rise in a host of health-related problems, a threefold increase in teen suicide, more adults with anxiety and depression, and more lifestyle and stress-related chronic physical health conditions. Keyes concludes, and I quote, "Increased life expectancy has increased the number of years spent living with chronic physical diseases and mental disorders rather than greater health, and that continued attempts to improve population health solely by disease and illness prevention have proven extremely costly and largely ineffective." Now, in the field of mental health, this paradigm shift toward positive psychology, or flourishing, which has been defined as optimal functioning, where the goal of mental health is not simply to promote the absence of illness or symptoms, but rather the presence of something positive in one's life. For example, a person might recover from clinical depression, where they might experience a reduction in sadness, more energy, and a return to normal functioning, but still not be flourishing. They might still hold on to anger or resentment, for example. In this case, the person might be said to be healed, but not whole. What is this something positive in flourishing? Researchers have identified three broad domains of flourishing. One, the presence of positive emotions, calm, peaceful, satisfaction with life. Two, positive psychological functioning, self-acceptance, purpose in life, positive relations with others. Three, positive social functioning, a sense of belonging and interest in others. An interesting question arises: can a person flourish while still experiencing emotional illness? The example of the saints, more recently the case of Mother Teresa, who reported years of depression, would not for 1 minute take away the very reality that she was indeed flourishing. According to a model that only sees that mental illness is on the opposite spectrum from health, this of course would not be possible. Either one would be free from depression and healthy, or depressed and unhealthy. However, when looking at a flourishing model, one sees that there are many other variables that account for flourishing besides the absence of mental illness. Positive psychology talks about the presence of character strengths and virtues as the tools for promoting flourishing. Researchers such as Seligman and Peterson have identified 24 such virtues. I will focus in this talk on 4 of these virtues: creativity, love, humility, and gratitude. Creativity falls along a spectrum with, of course, the Nobel laureates and great innovative minds representing one extreme, and those who never come up with an original idea on the other end of the spectrum. Most of us, however, function in the area of what might be called everyday creativity. This is the ability to generate creative solutions to the problems encountered at home and at work, perhaps not winning any special awards or recognition. The correlates of everyday creativity are an interest in a wide array of topics. A person who reads, for example, magazines in an area that are not his or her own particular area of interest. An openness to new experience and a willingness to take risks. How do we foster everyday creativity in our lives? First, it's important to defer judgment about the quality of our work, particularly in its initial stages. Any one of us who has begun a new project and has tried to make sure that every detail in the beginning is absolutely perfect soon realizes that the task will never be accomplished, and they need to let go of that perfectionism and obsessionality in order to let the project flow. Secondly, it's important to stop our ordinary work for a while to permit ideas to percolate, to take, as it were, fascination breaks, to permit creativity. A second virtue is love. Now, there are at least 3 types of love. One, which is akin to a child's love for a parent, where we rely on another to make our own welfare a priority.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.